عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن الله تجاوز لي عن أمة الخطأ والنسيان وما استكرهوا عليه.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والعاقبة للمتقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, in this topic, when we're talking about rahma, when we're talking about ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran something very, very important about the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that sometimes we misinterpret or we misunderstand. And many times when you don't speak Arabic or when you don't understand the language of the Quran, as you're reading through the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how many times have you come across a name in English that you didn't even understand? Like, what is this supposed to mean? Right? Or it's just duplication. Right? Allah is Ar-Rahman, Allah is Rahim, Allah is Ghafoor, Allah is Wadood, Allah is all of these things. And it'll be translated as, you know, compassionate, merciful, merciful, merciful. And then you'll see all kinds of other words that you've never even heard and that you don't even use in your vocabulary. And Allah tells us in the Quran, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. To Allah belong the most beautiful of names, so call upon Him with those names. Interact with Him with those names. And that's a very powerful thing, because if you really think about that, how are we supposed to interact with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and personalize our dua if we don't even know what His names truly mean? So then you come with, He's the most merciful. And we're buried in mercy. But then what is the difference between Rahman and Rahim? Because they come from the same word. Then where does Ghafoor come in, come into play? Where does Haleem come into play? What does Wadood mean? How do you bring all of this together? And how do you turn this into a fruitful conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How do you make this a successful dua? Because if you don't understand and don't ponder upon them, then your dua will lack quality just as you lack understanding of the one whom you're calling upon. So it's extremely important for us to analyze each and every single name and then to call upon Allah as He commands us in this verse and as we see in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. أنت الغني ونحن الفقراء إليك. You are the one who is in no need whatsoever. You have no needs. You are self-sufficient. And we are in need of you. أنت القوي ونحن الضعفاء إليك. You are the one who is endowed with all strength and power. And we are the ones who are in need of you. We are the weak ones. We are the ones who have no strength. This is how you interact with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understanding His names. So I just want to look at, from the few moments that we have, these names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala: Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Ghafoor, Al-Haleem, Al-Wadood. Five names that I want you to take home with you tonight, and I want you to be able to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with these names, and I want you to have a full understanding of them. You see, if you translate it as mercy, mercy can mean many things in the English language, and in fact, mercy can be devoid of love. Right? If you see a cat on the road that's been hit by a car, and you go and you pick that cat off of the road and you throw him on the side, you committed an act of mercy. You showed an act of mercy to that cat, but that doesn't mean that you love that cat. And so saying Allah is most merciful, using the word mercy, is truly not enough to really convey the meaning of this beautiful name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and these two names that we are commanded to start every surah in the Quran, with the exception of one, with the name that we say, or the names that we pronounce as we leave our homes, enter our homes, begin our meals, at the end of our meals, you know, and beginning every act of worship, and even acts that are not acts of worship. Allah wants us to consistently be reminded, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, in the name of Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. And if we look at the root of this word, we truly understand something. They both come from the word Rahmah. And in the Arabic language, the word Rahim refers to the womb, right? When you say Sillatul Rahim, connecting or establishing and upholding ties of kinship, you're talking about the womb. And so the scholars say something very beautiful about this. The strongest form of love that exists on the face of the earth is the love that a mother has for her child. It's not just mercy. It's a different type of love, right? You know, sometimes you would see a woman, when her baby starts crying, she starts crying too, right? And if you're a man, you think that's psychotic. You're like, what's wrong with you? But it's a whole nother form of love. And a mother will always be open to her child. A mother will always yearn for her child. It's the strongest form of love that exists, and that's why the Prophet ﷺ chose that incident to bring into light this beautiful name and attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the incident in which a woman ran between the ranks of the Sahaba as they were carrying their swords to find her child, and she grabbed her child, and when she grabbed her child, she started to suckle him, holding him so tight, and the Sahaba were in awe, and the Prophet ﷺ wanted to make light of this incident and said, you see that? Do you think that woman would ever throw her child into a fire? You think that woman would ever throw her child into a fire? Allah is more merciful and compassionate with you than that mother is with her child. That's not just in dunya, that's in akhirah. As Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah said, if I had a choice to be judged on the day of judgment by Allah or by my parents, I would choose Allah. Because Allah has more rahmah with me than my own two parents. You imagine that? So then you might be thinking to yourself, if that's the case, then why does hellfire exist? And the answer is, as Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah said, لَقَدْ خَابَ وَخَسَرْ مَنْ خَرَجَ عَنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ الَّتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. A person has failed and lost when he manages to miss the mercy of Allah that has encompassed all things. Imagine what it would take for that woman to throw her child into the fire. Likewise, there are things that the human being does to reach hellfire, to reach Jahannam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only is He merciful with him, not only does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow him to benefit from his mercy, because in this life everyone benefits from ar-Rahman. The kuffar, the disbelievers, those who would curse God benefit from ar-Rahman. The love that a mother has for her child is a manifestation of ar-Rahman. The mercy and love and compassion between two animals is from the rahmah of ar-Rahman. But then you say, wait a minute, what about us? What about the believers? Right? That's why Allah is Rahim. Rahmanun fi dunya, Rahimun fi akhirah. He is exclusively merciful, Rahim, to the believers on the day of judgment. There's a special type of mercy that's there. And then you might think to yourself, well, wait a minute. Allah is Rahman, inclusively merciful, Rahim, exclusively merciful. But how do I know that I can qualify for a Rahim? Because I'm so terrible, I've done so much. And you know, that's what the shaytan does to you. He comes to you before you commit a sin, and shaytan is your favorite mufti in the world. You don't need to look for any website. He tells you, come on man, it's halal. MashaAllah, you pray. MashaAllah, you fast. MashaAllah, you wear hijab. You go to the masjid. You're good. What are you worried about? Shaytan tells you it's all good. And Allah is Rahman, Allah is Rahim. Shaytan reminds you Allah is Rahman, Rahim. And shaytan tells you how great you are. The minute that you commit the sin, shaytan tells you how vengeful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and tells you how horrible you are. He completely flips the script on you. And so people end up despairing. It goes from a healthy fear, which is khashya, to an unhealthy fear, which is despair. What makes me think that I can enter into Jannah? I've committed all of these sins. Well, first and foremost, Allah is Halim. Allah is the one who's forbearing. And to truly understand that forbearance, imagine if Allah punished everyone right when they committed the sin. You imagine, right when you commit the sin, a lightning bolt comes and strikes you and you're dead. Imagine how that would be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if every single time a person cursed, if every single time a person committed zina, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went ahead and took him then. Allah punished him then and threw him into hellfire. Allah doesn't do that. Allah is Halim. He's forbearing. So much so that the Prophet ﷺ said what? Now we've all heard the hadith, أَتَّائِبُ مِنَ الذَّنْ كَمَنْ لَا ذَنْبَ لَهُ. The one who repents from sin is like the one who's never sinned before. But there's a whole other level there. Rasulullah ﷺ says in the authentic hadith in Al-Bayhaqi, from Umama radiallahu anhu, that whenever a person commits a sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the angel on his left, hold your pen for 6 hours. Subhanallah. Don't even write it down. Give him a chance. You know, sometimes right when you commit a sin, you realize it right away, especially those who are close to Allah. Right? They feel that guilt sooner and with more severity. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهُ. Those who, whenever they commit a sin, whenever they commit an act of disobedience, of open public sin, or any type of sin, they harm themselves. Right away, ذَكَرُوا اللَّهُ. They remember Allah and they say, oh my God, I can't believe I did that. فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ. So they immediately start to make istighfar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't even allow that sin to be written down in the first place. Allahu Akbar. Allah is Haleem. But wait a minute. What if the sin carried on? What if it carried on and what if I didn't repent in 6 hours? What if I have a character flaw that's been destroying me for 10, 15 years? What if I've been committing the same sin over and over and over again? I understand the hadith about the 6 hours, but now I really have no hope. That's why Allah is Al-Ghafoor. You know what Ghufran means? Ghafoor means? It's literally to take a hot pot, you know, boiling water, and to cover it up in a way that not only does the water not come out, but it actually cools down. Allah covers it up for you. Forgive and forget. SubhanAllah. That's how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Allah is Ghafoor. But you know what? What if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is out to get me? What if I've sinned so much? What if Allah just doesn't want to forgive me? You know, sometimes you find leaders that just quite frankly don't like you. What if Allah just doesn't like me? Well, that's why Allah is Al-Wadud. He's the most loving. SubhanAllah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't just tell us that Allah will forgive and Allah is merciful and Allah shows pity. No, it's more comprehensive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you and I to succeed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is willing to overlook 50 years of sin for a day of obedience if a person died on that. Allah is willing to let it all go. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says something very beautiful. He says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you were not to sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would remove you all and would replace you with the people who would sin so they could seek His forgiveness so He could forgive them. You know, they say the beauty of an artist, right? When someone claims to be an artist, it shows in his art, right? That's when you really know the beauty of the artist. You know, SubhanAllah, Shaykh Yasir Rajas, Afidullah, he said a very powerful story to me. He was telling me the story just last week about a man who committed a huge sin, destroyed his family, huge sin. And it was bad. It wasn't like I looked at a girl or I went out or I got caught. No, it was bad. Real bad. Shaykh Yasir says, I asked him. He said, do you know why Allah is Al-Ghafoor? You know why Allah is Al-Ghafoor? Because people like you exist. SubhanAllah. That's why Allah is Al-Ghafoor. You need Allah to cover up for you. We all need Allah to cover up for us. We need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us out on the Day of Judgment, because none of us are going to make it by deeds. We're all going to make it by His mercy. And the goal is to just try to qualify for His mercy. But you want to know how easy that is? Remember what Umar ibn Abdul Aziz said? What a loser you are if you manage to miss the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me tell you how easy it is. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if someone has a good intention and he follows it up with a good deed, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala write down for him? What does Allah write down for him? 10 good deeds, up to 700, up to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to write for him. Allah multiplies it. And if a person has a bad intention but ends up committing a good deed, now that doesn't mean you have a bad intention when you commit the good deed. You start off with a bad intention, then something happens along the way. You know what? It manifests itself in a good deed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does what? He writes down the good deed for him. It's okay, don't sweat it, you're forgiven. And then, now if you have a bad intention and you commit a bad deed, you know, usually as human beings, do we reward more whenever people are generous with us, whenever people treat us in a way that they deserve reward, with rewardable behavior? Or do we punish more whenever people offend us? We multiply the anger, we multiply the punishment. Right? You could have been good to a person forever. You could have treated that person with good manners. You messed up one time. I've never seen anything good from you. You're terrible. You've never treated me with love. You've never loved me. You've never done this. We always multiply punishment. We exaggerate the punishment. Allah does the total opposite. You have a bad intention, you commit the sin, Allah writes it down for you as a sin. Just one. And inshallah ta'ala, Allah is ghafoor, He can forgive it. He can cover it up. Now the last one, and this is just incredible. When a person has a bad intention, it doesn't manifest itself in a bad deed, right? He makes the intention to commit evil, but it doesn't manifest itself. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Somebody tell me, I know you guys are sleeping. Somebody tell me, what does Allah do for that person? No, not only does He not write it down, Allah writes down a good deed for him. Subhanallah. You imagine somebody coming to your house with a baseball bat to tear up your car, beat up your car, and then when they got to your house, they felt bad about it, and you walked outside and you found that person, you know, holding the baseball bat and about to hit the car, and they said, ugh. And they walked up to the door and said, look, I was coming to your house to break your car up, to bust your car up, but I decided not to, I just wanted to apologize. And you say, hey, well, let me pay you for the gas. How much did you buy that bat for? Allah writes down a good deed for you. Allahu Akbar. How amazing is Allah? How loving is Allah? How merciful is Allah? How forbearing is Allah? How compassionate is Allah? SubhanAllah. And we see incidents in the seerah that we look over and over and over again, or a hadith that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned to us of stories. The man who killed 99 people. Think of the worst serial killer you've ever seen. Right? Think of O.J. Simpson, for example. That's a really unrepentant guy, right? Killed his wife, got away with it, then wrote a book that said, if I would have killed my wife, this is how I would have done it. Wink, wink. Imagine that guy coming up to a sheikh and saying, hey, you think I can get away with this stuff? This guy killed 99, and he went to a righteous person, and he said to him, not a scholar, he went to a worshipper, a good guy, rahib, someone who worshipped a lot, and he said, I've killed 99 people, can I be forgiven? Do I have any chance, or am I done for? And he says, you killed 99 people? Are you serious? You think you just say astaghfirullah, start over, it's done? Are you serious? Now the worshipper, he's worshipping Allah all the time. He's, subhanAllah, caught up in his own self. So the man has such a serious temper issue. Not only does he say, you know, go away, or not only does he not, you know, curse him out and just leave the masjid, or spit on him and punch him in the face, he kills him. That's how addicted he's gotten to killing. You know, when you do a sin over and over and over again, it doesn't matter how severe the sin is. He killed the guy because he didn't like his answer. Understanding his situation. Then he went to a scholar, he said, look, I killed 100 people, the last one being, you know, that righteous worshiper, the guy that was always in the masjid, I killed him too. Any chance? He said, yeah. No one's going to prevent you from being forgiven by Allah. Allah is ghafoor. But you need to go start your life over, right? Left the masjid, decided to go start his life over, died on the way. Now seriously, if it was any one of us judging that person, what would we say? He didn't change. Seriously? You're going to let go of 100 murders because he decided to start moving towards another land? He probably would have found a guy over there and said, hey look, I want to buy a house here. Got any real estate advice? No, I'm kind of busy. He probably would have killed him too. Guy had some serious issues with killing people. We wouldn't have forgiven him. We would have looked at him with a skeptical eye. But how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala look at him? When the angels came to Allah, we don't know what to do with this guy. This is a case that puzzles us. And Allah says, well, just measure the distance between the land he left and the land he went to. Had Allah stopped there and not said anything else, That is already incredible mercy, beyond human capacity, beyond what we could fathom. But Allah didn't stop there. The man was actually closer to the land that he left. And Allah struck the earth so that he could be closer to the land he was going to. SubhanAllah. Wallahu yuridu an yatuba alaykum. Allah is a tawwab. Allah is a tawwab. The one who turns to you. Tawwab literally means, inaba is literally to turn to you. And subhanAllah, some people came to Aisha radiallahu anha and they said to Aisha, how can we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How can we do tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Aisha says, Allah turned towards you before you turned to Him, just by you asking the question. فَتَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ لِيَتُوبُ. Allah says in the Qur'an, Allah turned to them so they could turn to Him. SubhanAllah. That's Allah. That's who we've got. That's who's going to question us on the Day of Judgment. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? That's the one who's going to question us. That's the one who's going to look at me and who's going to say, here are the deeds that you've committed. That's who I have to face on the Day of Judgment. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Because we learn in the seerah also of another man who did no good in his life. The Rasulullah said that whenever the time of death came, then it occurred to him that, you know what, I've been messing up my entire life. So he told his children what? He said, burn me to ashes so Allah can't get me. I'm afraid of God. I don't want Him to get me. Just burn me to ashes. I've got no time left to repent. It's over with. I'm gone. Right? Burn me to ashes. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would gather him up on the Day of Judgment and would say, oh my slave, why did you do that? And what would he say? Khashaytuka ya Rabb, I was afraid of you, oh my Lord. Wa anta a'lam, and you know that. I was just afraid of you, oh Allah. What was the answer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What does Allah say back to him? Somebody tell me, what does Allah say back to him? So I can show you what you miss when you read over a hadith quickly. What did he say back to him? He forgave him, right? But it's even more powerful than that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, فَغَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَهُ بِذَلِكَ. Allah forgave him because he burned himself. Allah forgave him by virtue of the sin. Because Allah recognized his heart when he committed that major sin. SubhanAllah. That's what we're dealing with. That's who's going to question us on the Day of Judgment. Allah wants you to turn to Him. Allah wants you to be forgiven. And in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you every single chance, so much so that the Prophet said, a person can make istighfar and tawbah to Allah until he starts foaming at the mouth. You know when you're dying and you're foaming at the mouth and you're not making sense anymore? Allah will forgive you until that moment. No matter what you've done, what you've done, you can still be forgiven. And we even see that Fir'aun, someone would say, well, what about Fir'aun? When did Fir'aun decide to make tawbah? Whenever the water was already in his lungs and he was drowning, then he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. You know what Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says? He says, Jibreel alayhi salam. And who knows Allah better than Jibreel? Right? The angel that carries the message to all of the messengers. Who knows Allah better than Jibreel alayhi salam? Jibreel was afraid that Fir'aun, with all that he's done, still had a chance of being forgiven. So he went under the sea and he started kicking dirt into his mouth. That shows you. Jibreel, who knows Allah, he knows Allah was even capable of forgiving Fir'aun. Shaytan, and Imam Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah says something so powerful. Allah is so merciful that Shaytan, with all that he's done, on the Day of Judgment would think he has a chance. After making the challenge and all that, he would still think he has a chance. Because that's Allah. That's Ar-Rahman. That's Ar-Rahim. That's Al-Ghafoor. That's Al-Wadud. That's Al-Haleem. That's At-Tawwab. That's Allah. That's who we're dealing with. That's the one who judges us. Not everybody else. That's the one who's going to look at us. And that's the one who recognizes even the smallest effort. You're trying. And sometimes we go to extremes, and many times we go to extremes. And Ali radiallahu anhu said, may Allah bless the scholar, the greatest faqih is the one who makes a person feel hopeful in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without giving him the concession to disobey him. You know, many times when we say, Allah is ghafoor raheem, you don't tell a patient who's sick that go ahead and keep disobeying Allah because Allah is ghafoor raheem. You need to remind yourself with the proper names at that moment. Sometimes you need to scare yourself, right? Sometimes you need to scare yourself and say, well, Allah is ghafoor raheem, but Allah is also azizun duntiqam. And when Ibrahim alayhi salam was speaking to his father and doing da'wah to his father, he says, Ya abati, inni akhafu an yamassaka adabun min ar-Rahman fatakuna lish-shaytani waliya. I'm afraid punishment is going to come to you from who? You know, when you're trying to scare someone, you're not going to say, punishment's going to come from ar-Rahman. What are you going to say? Punishment is going to come from al-Aziz. Punishment's going to come from al-Jabbar. Punishment's going to come from the most powerful, Al-Qawi, Al-Qahhar, the one who subdues. You better be careful with Al-Qahhar. Ibrahim alayhi salam said, I'm afraid Ar-Rahman will punish you. You know what they say in the Arabic language? There's a saying, Ittaqi ghadab al-Halim. Fear the anger of a person who's excessively forbearing. You know that person that never gets angry? When they get angry, how bad is their anger? It's really bad. It took a lot to push that person to that anger. You don't want to see them angry. A person who virtually never gets angry. You don't want to see that person angry. So Ibrahim alayhi salam was saying to his father, yes, he's Ar-Rahman. I just told you about Ar-Rahman 3 times. But his being Ar-Rahman won't stop him from punishing you. You don't want to be punished by Ar-Rahman. And Allah doesn't want to punish us. And in fact, Ar-Rahman is more pleased with the tawbah of his servant than the servant is with his own tawbah. I want to end with one story. And subhanAllah, this story is so incredible because I looked back at some of the incidents of people that should have died in a car accident, that should have died on drugs, that should have caught AIDS because they slept around over 100 times. I've seen people like that, and Allah still gave them a chance. It's like, wow. Allah still gave that person a chance, right? Why did Allah care about him? Right? He's a loser. You know that kid in the masjid, they're the one who doesn't come to the masjid anymore, that's gone so bad that people just gave up on him? Allah didn't give up on him. And Imam al-Razi rahimahullah, he says something very beautiful, and I want you to think about this tonight. Think deeply about how much Allah cares about you. And Imam al-Razi says, one day I went out after Salat al-Fajr, and the habit of the Salihin was to find a quiet place to do tadabbur and tafakkur, to contemplate, right? On the shores, at the ocean, in the mountains, just outside, on your roof, whatever it is, to contemplate, take a break from the world, and tadabbur wa tafakkur, and make dhikr. So this was his habit every morning, rahimahullah ta'ala. So he says, one day I went out on the shore to make tafakkur, to contemplate and to remember Allah. And he said, as I was looking around, I saw a scorpion and a turtle. Right? And the scorpion was after the turtle. You know, he's picking at the turtle. Right? You know, turtle sitting there barely walking, stuff like that, barely able to move. And the scorpion's messing with the turtle, but he's not killing him. So he said, I just sat there and I watched, and I said, subhanAllah, this is amazing. Then he says, the scorpion turned towards me. Now I personally remember in 2003 one time, I was walking down a hill from Salat al-Maghrib in Jordan. And as I was walking down this hill, I noticed this humongous scorpion behind me. I ran like a little girl, as fast as I could. That was the scariest moment of my life. I just looked back, I was like, oh. I didn't curse them. So Imam al-Razi rahimahullah says, I'm sitting there watching and the scorpion turned towards me and it zoomed towards me, but it passed me up. Right? It came by me, but it didn't come at me, and it just kept going. As if it was going somewhere, right? As if it had heard some kind of call and it went somewhere. So I got curious, so I followed the scorpion. I was like, this is a strange scorpion. It didn't even try to kill me. So I followed the scorpion. And I saw a man sleeping under a tree. And while the man was sleeping under the tree, follow me with the story, there's a lot of animals involved. While the man is sleeping under the tree, a snake was about to bite him. And as the snake was about to get him, and before I could even say anything, the scorpion jumped on the snake, it stung him, the snake died and the scorpion died. So Imam al-Razi said, Imam al-Razi rahimahullah, he goes, wow, Allah caused all of that to happen, right? Just so that man could be protected. Man, Allah loves his servants. He was so touched by that incident. Allah cared enough about him to make that happen. Now that in and of itself is incredible, right? Now if you're in his situation and you just saw that take place, you know that this man must be someone beloved to Allah. This must be a special person. This must be one of the awliya. So you want to know this person. You want to ask him, hey, make dua for me. I just saw this happen. So Imam al-Razi rahimahullah said, I went up to him, I woke him up so that I could ask him to make dua for me so that I can explain to him the incident. And when he woke up, his breath reeked of alcohol. He was drunk. Imam al-Razi said, Allahu Akbar. I thought this was some wali that Allah was protecting and sent all this, had all this take place. So he was disappointed, and he was obviously disappointed, and the man said, what's going on? Right? Hangover. What's going on? So Imam al-Razi told him the story. He said, well, I just saw the scorpion that was messing with the turtle and then came at me but passed me up and didn't hurt me and ran towards a snake that was about to bite you and killed the snake and killed itself so that you could be protected. And I thought to myself, wow, Allah really loves this person. So I went to befriend the awliya of Allah. And the man started to cry. And he said, Allah did that for me? Allah did that for me? This pitiful servant. Allah cared that much about me. How many of us have woken up from a hangover? Allah cared that much about this pitiful servant. So this man made tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a result of that. فَأَصْبَحَ ذَٰلِكَ الرَّجُلُ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ الصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ So he became one of the people that always prayed in the first line in the masjid. SubhanAllah, Allah wants to forgive you. Allah wants to accept your repentance. Allah wants to show mercy upon you. And on the day of judgment, Allah doesn't even want to ask you about your deeds, because the Prophet ﷺ says, مَنْ يُوْقِشُ الْحِسَابِ عُذِّبْ Whoever is asked on the day of judgment will perish. He will be punished. And Aisha radiallahu anha said, but wait a minute, what about وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِ فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا What about the ayah that whoever receives their book in their right hand, they will have an easy accountability? Allah is clearly mentioning a hisab here. And Rasulullah says, لا يا عائش ذلك العرض No, O Aisha, that is just the presentation of the deeds. But Allah won't even ask the believers. Allah will just tell you, you're forgiven. You made istighfar, don't worry about it. You're forgiven. Here's your book in your right hand. Abshir ya abdi. It's over. It's over. Khalas. Go take your book to the scale. Then. You're in Jannah. You don't even have to be asked. You made an effort. You knew Allah was Ghafoor Rahim, and so you turned to Him. And in the ayah in the Quran, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا Say, O my servants who have wronged themselves, never despair from the mercy of Allah, because Allah covers all sins. And immediately afterwards, a call to action. وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ But you're not going to have that lead time all the time. Some people don't get a chance to make tawbah. So as soon as you've come to that realization, hurry up and turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ Submit yourself to Him. Submit yourself to Him. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابِ ثُمَّ لَا تُنْصَرُونَ Before a punishment comes to you, and you would not be protected then. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show mercy and love upon us, His pitiful servants. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us worthy of His rahmah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Ya Rahman Irhamna. We ask Allah the most merciful to show mercy upon us, the most compassionate to show compassion upon us. We ask Allah Al-Haleem, the one who is forbearing, to be forbearing with us. We ask Allah Al-Ghafoor, the one who covers sins, to cover our sins. We ask Allah Al-Wadood, the loving, to love us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at-tawwab to turn towards us so that we may turn to Him and experience the light of guidance. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.